We're going to go ahead and get started. Thank you everyone for joining us this afternoon. I am Kimberly Wickert, the Director of Organizational Partnerships with Retain Kentucky, and thank you for spending some time with us today. Just a few housekeeping items. There is live transcription enabled, and if you choose to, you can disable that on your end. We also will have a couple polling questions that will come up at the beginning of our time today. If you could just answer those, we would appreciate it. And if you do have questions during the presentation, our presenters will answer those for you. I'll be monitoring those. You can type those into the Q&A or the chat box, and we will answer those as we are going through the presentation today. I would like to welcome our presenters today who are kind enough to spend some time and share some great information and takeaways. Today, we have a presentation on return to work, the engagement of employees with injury or illness in a COVID world. And our presenters are Marcy Ledford, who is the Health and Productivity Director at Unum. And Marcy's been providing return to work and absence management services for more than 20 years. She has her degree in rehabilitation counseling from the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, and currently she is the Health and Productivity Director at Unum. Her favorite part of her role as the director is providing meaningful data to clients and helping them understand how to use it to improve the health and productivity of their workforce. Marcy frequently authors articles and presents on topics related to absence management, workforce trends, and return to work. She also enjoys spending time with her family, cheering for her son on the soccer field, and cheering on the Tennessee Vols. We also have Derek Stern joining us today, who joined Unum as Director of Health and Productivity in 2018. In his role, he is responsible for providing consultative support to large case clients in their goal to reduce absences. Focal points include return to work programs, lost time analyses, and benchmarking client performance against their peers. Prior to joining Unum, Derek was a vice president of customer relations of CareWorks of Ohio Limited, where he spent more than 20 years implementing return to work programs and ensuring the success of his clients in managing their workers' compensation programs. He worked with public sector employers such as state universities, cities, and townships, and helped them implement and maintain their stay at work and return to work programs. Derek is a graduate of Hiram College in Ohio and lives in Michigan with his wife and three children. So welcome, Marcy and Derek. Thanks for joining us today, and I'm going to turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Kimberly. I love that Derek and I do the same job, but we have totally different descriptions of how we do that. So just to show you how diverse this world is that we are operating in. Thanks for having us, and definitely thanks everyone for joining. This is just a super high level glance at what we're going to cover today. Primarily, we want to talk about some of the trends that we have seen around the shift to remote work, how that's changed over the last 18 months. Talk about some of the concerns that we've experienced through the employers that we support, things we've heard from them, things we've experienced with supporting them, especially those that are related to physical and mental health, as well as, you know, the others in between. And then, of course, we'll wrap up with some best practices that we want to leave with you in terms of how to connect with employees in this new world we're in. You can go to the next slide, Kimberly. So I'm assuming this is not an astonishing number that you're seeing here, which is basically 70% of white collar employees are working remotely. I think we've seen some shift in probably 2021. We do have some folks that made that transition back to the office, but essentially over the last 18 months, we have had a huge shift to working from home, and a lot of that being for folks who've never worked at home before. And I am sure there are people on this call who have experienced that. I occasionally worked at home, but to go to working at home 5 days a week for over a year was definitely a shift for even myself and those in my household. I would say pre-COVID, we had some remote work. You know, stats vary depending on the surveys you look at. And, you know, 15 to 20% is about what I found to be the average. And most folks weren't working completely 5 days a week at home. A lot of flex, a lot of hybrid, you know, when folks could, when it was convenient. Obviously, there were some industries such as the tech industry that had a higher percentage of folks working at home completely. Then insert COVID in March of 2020, and we saw a scramble for both employees and employers. I think we focus a lot on the remote work piece for employees, but employers were in a whole new position. We work with a lot of employers who don't allow any type of work at home, either as a regular part of the work environment or as any type of workplace accommodation. There's no work at home, and that's even some of our white collar employers. And so I think making that quick shift to Do we get laptops to everyone? Do people have a chair that's decent to sit in and a desk to work at? We saw a lot of companies offering to let employees come in, pick up items, or hey, we'll give you, you know, so much money to spend if you want to go out and get these items to make sure you've at least got what you need at home. And we'll talk more about some of the specifics of what we started to see happening in that home workplace around that. The other thing, we'll talk about this a little bit more, but one thing that we really saw is, you know, these are rookie work at home employees. So a lot of shift to how do I make this work? How do I balance? I want to work. I want to be a good employee, but I've got my kids at home, and throw a whole nother wrench in, which is kids were at home. So now you're an employee and a homeschool teacher. And so we saw a lot happening around that. And then now we're starting to see what's going to happen in the future around work at home. Like I said, you know, we had some working at home before, not a high number. Now we're looking at 70% of white collar workers being at home. Obviously, that's lower on the blue collar end, but some of those folks were totally shut down for a while, and then the majority did return back to their typical work site. But now, what do employers do? And there's again, lots of surveys out there. A couple of the things I read said about 60 to 70% of employers are going to allow some type of remote work at home, flex, hybrid, whatever all the different organizations are calling it in the future. Kimberly, you can go to the next slide. So, and again, it was kind of interesting that if you think about what employees want now as well, I think there's a study by Employment Hero, which said 55% of employees would look elsewhere right now if their work from home option was taken away. So we have employees who've gotten very comfortable being at home, but what does that look like for them? So this is just kind of outlining some of the good and bad, and you will see that there's some of the same things fall under both good and bad, because there's a question of, is it a positive or a negative for working at home? And honestly, it depends sometimes on the situation. But you know, a lot of increased flexibility, that's a given. Savings, financial savings, and that was from commute, you know, not paying for gas, not eating out, clothes, makeup. Ladies, I've saved a lot on makeup over the last 18 months, definitely. So, I mean, we don't think about those things ordinarily, but there were a lot of just small things that added up over that time period that were great for working at home. And then there's the obvious, which is hopefully we stayed healthier. The majority of us stayed safe at home and away from COVID exposure. That was the whole goal, obviously. I think the biggest one that I teetered back and forth with is this good, is this bad, was productivity. And if you read some of the data out there, some of the research out there, employee surveys will say, oh yeah, my productivity's up. Our employees are more productive. Some will say it's down because there are distractions. There are things occurring in the home that maybe have hurt productivity. So I think there's a lot of situation there where it depends on the employee, the type of work being done, and the home situation that was created with all of these shifts. I mentioned that 2/3 of our employees who went home to work were remote. Rookie remote workers. I was one of those. I occasionally worked at home in between traveling or, you know, with a sick kid, but I was an office gal. And so transitioning home was a shift for me. And I think all those things listed there were applicable to me. There's distraction, and we increase those distractions again with having kids at home and just a different scenario happening at home than if you just typically said, I'm going to work at home. And we'll talk more about this, obviously, on some of these future slides, but collaboration definitely changed. You know, sitting in a conference room with four or five people and hammering out ideas, brainstorming, meeting. It's almost a way of the past. So that had to shift, and you had to think about how do we now collaborate? And hopefully as managers had to step in and say, you know, here are some ideas. And then it's that in that same token, we saw a lot of social isolation, and that was not just work related. That was in our lives in general. We saw a lot of people start to struggle with, I'm not getting out, I'm not going anywhere, I'm not going to work. And we did, you know, on our end, we definitely saw our trends shift toward an increase in anxiety and just a lot of factors happening. And I think that has a really long tail. We at Unum are still very much focusing on behavioral health and what's happening there, because I don't think that changed just because we're in a new year and because a few people went back to work and COVID went down. Of course, now COVID's kind of trending back up, and folks who thought they were going back to the office are not. So I think that just continues to be an issue. And then again, that sort of that work-life balance and productivity hand in hand are back under this section for me, because I think it depended on the situation. The other thing I saw that was really a factor is, do managers trust their employees who are working at home? I think that plays into that productivity. So I think it's very much manager style. Again, I think it depends on the type of work being done at home and the type of professional doing that work as to whether or not employees were more productive or less productive. Hopefully over this period of 18 months, it has increased as folks adjusted to this new schedule and this new way of life. So I'm going to hand off to Derek, and let's talk about some of those specific challenges.
Great. Thank you, Marcy. Good afternoon, everybody. Unlike Marcy, I can kind of come at this from a different perspective. I've been a at-home worker since 1999, I was two when I started. So, you know, a lot of what my colleagues went through when that shift to home was something that I had already dealt with. What was a challenge for me from a physical perspective was I was not used to being at home all the time. My job is about 50% office work, or, you know, working from home, and 50% travel. And all of a sudden I went for 18 months of no travel. So that was a bit of a challenge from a physical standpoint, and also just from an overall standpoint, with, as Marcy mentioned, you know, kids were home. Which my kids are older, so not that big of a deal, but more importantly, I was home. My wife was working from home, so we're all at home all of a sudden. The nice thing was my kids actually all of a sudden gained an understanding of why I was asking them all the time to be quiet while I was on a work call, because then they started asking me to be quiet while they were in one of their Zoom meetings with their classmates. So kind of a little bit of turnabout was fair play, so that was nice. But as you know, as colleagues started to shift to home, we all started to deal with that lack of dedicated office space. You know, some have maybe one office in their house, and now you have three or four, sometimes five or six people that are vying for that space in which you can have a meeting and have that quiet time. Sometimes that area is a kitchen table or a kitchen counter. And I know I've seen a lot of my colleagues' dogs, cats, kids, everything running through the background of our meetings. And that's just something that in the past, I think prior to COVID, would have been somewhat taboo and is now very much commonplace and accepted practice, which I think is great. So, you know, but sometimes that lack of dedicated office space can lead to other things from an ergonomic standpoint too, like the improper setup of a workspace. Working solely off of a laptop can be one of those issues that can create some ergonomic issues that can, you can encounter some back issues, some carpal tunnel like issues. So making sure that we're looking at those types of things, as well as working longer hours, or maybe not even longer hours at times, but sometimes it's different hours. I know for me, work is always here, right? Because I work from home, my work is always here. And sometimes that's really good because I can knock things out. Sometimes that can be really bad when you're knocking things out at 10 o'clock at night. So making sure that we are maintaining that break between home life and work life can be challenged when we're working from home. And of course, you know, just lack of movement altogether, right? I make sure to take breaks get up, walk around. But, you know, oftentimes, again, work is always here. We're not getting up and driving into the office or walking into the office or bicycling into the office. However, people were getting to the office before, that is no longer taking place. And just that movement is no longer taking place. So that is can create some of the issues that you see on the slide in front of you, that those wrist and arm pain, the hip and knee pain, poor circulation, and of course, some eye strain as well from constantly looking at a smaller monitor from a laptop perspective. Kimberly, if you want to go to the next slide, we'll kind of talk about some of the other challenges with respect to workplace and kind of that mental and emotional challenge. Marcy already mentioned the social isolation. That's kind of a big deal. I don't want to underplay that that fact, because we all went from a situation where, you know, work is work, but it's also an opportunity to be social. And all of a sudden we have moved to a very antisocial environment where we're not really interacting with others face to face as we would have done in the past. And that has been very difficult and continues to be very difficult for a lot of people. That's why, you know, a lot of meetings that we do are on camera, just so we have that connection with each other from a face-to-face standpoint. And then anxiety and job insecurity. Marcy mentioned this, and we see it from a Unum standpoint within our data. We saw a large spike in anxiety-related claims as COVID took hold. And the directors, the four of us, were sitting around and we were kind of talking about it as COVID was starting to take effect. And we predicted that would happen. And fortunately, this is one of those instances where, you know, collectively we predicted correctly and we were able to give our clients some advance notice and give them some ideas of things that they could do to mitigate some of that anxiety from creeping into the job place. So, but it is very real, you know, anxiety about being at home, anxiety about COVID, anxiety about returning to the workplace. You know, I know from a Unum perspective, as COVID has, we've had these various ways, we've had different announcements about returning to the workplace and not returning to the workplace. And I'm sure for some that is anxiety inducing, just with the fact that we're planning for kids, we're planning for all types of things around that return to the workplace. So, all of that can be can create a lot of personal distractions, and, you know, just making sure that everybody is focused on everything that would allow them to work through some of those issues. And of course, we're constantly getting a barrage of news about COVID, right? I can't think of any time that I've looked at my phone, turned on the television, you know, talked to somebody where we have not had a discussion about COVID in some way, shape, or form. It has definitely shaped our society over the last 18 months. I think it's going to continue to shape our society for a while. And so that obviously is an emotional challenge, as well as we are starting to deal with somewhat of a new normal and work through some of that. And of course, all of that can lead to exacerbation of pre-existing conditions, whether those be mental or physical. Some of the conditions we talked about before from the physical side, but also on the mental side, can be exacerbated by this isolation that we're all feeling. So Marcy and I have given you a lot of the negatives and a lot of the challenges. As we go to the next slide, we'll talk about some of the ways that we have seen our clients and other employers in the industry kind of working through this. And so from an overall standpoint, and I think this is true in anything that you are trying to push out to employees, whether it be related to COVID or not related to COVID, is having that leadership presence. And very quickly, what we saw within our own company is our leadership team started doing weekly connects, of course, via video, but it was live video. So we were actually connected via live video with our CEO to just kind of let us know what was going on, what the plans were, what they were going to do as we looked at a, you know, is this going to be temporary, right? At first, we all thought this was going to be a 3-week work from home period and everybody's going to come back into the workplace. You know, I commend Unum for being extremely forthcoming and extremely transparent with plans, and understanding that, you know, obviously all of this was very new as well. And so we were pivoting as we were moving forward and as we were getting new information. And they did a fantastic job of just making sure that everybody was aware of what was going on. And as they gained new information, they were passing it back and forth to us, which I think was very good. And as part of each of those quick connects, they also had a Q&A period where we could type in questions and they would be able to answer those questions that were coming directly from us. So it wasn't just our leadership giving information to us. We were actually able to ask questions of them and get the information that we needed. And I think that kind of goes hand in hand with number two there, and that is over communicating. Just making sure that, you know, making sure everybody is aware of the situation, aware of what's going on, and just consistently and constantly passing that message along.
And Derek, I was just going to add on the over communicate. I think it's just, and you mentioned this earlier, there are so many unknowns for employees right now. And so I think any way that you can help resolve that by too many details. And normally we would say, you know, don't inundate them with details. But I think right now in the time we're in, you know, employees are trying to make decisions about, do I vaccinate or not? Do I homeschool my child? Do I send them to school? Do I go into the office? Do I not? And so I think the details that you provide them give them finally some known information as opposed to all the unknowns, and hopefully play into some of that reduced anxiety that we've seen.
Yep, great point, Marcy. I'm going to jump around a little bit on this slide as well, but just, I think one of the big things that we did, and actually Marcy and I kind of worked on this project pre-COVID, and it really took hold during COVID, it became very important, was providing tips on proper worksite ergonomics. And Marcy and I had worked very closely together to create a booklet that our clients would be able to use with their employees to share best practices. In some cases, it was lifting, pulling, reaching, you know, and somebody who may be in a manufacturing environment, but also in a home office environment, and giving some tips for proper setup of your work site, of your monitor, of your chair, and exactly how you should set up that office space. And little did Marcy and I know that this would be really key, as at Unum, I think within 2 to 3 days of shutdown, we had 98 or 99% of our employees working from home. So everybody had a laptop already, and they were just sent home to work remotely. So that was a lot of employees who we mentioned before had to make sure that they had their office space properly set up. The last thing that we wanted, as Kimberly mentioned, my background is workers' compensation. So the last thing that I wanted to see was a bunch of work-related injuries from an improper desk setup, because somebody was getting an overuse type of injury. So this was very quickly deployed, a very quickly deployed guide to all of our employees to let them know of those proper techniques that they could follow to reduce the impact of that new work from home environment in which they found themselves.
And the only other piece I would add on that's really important is that, so the ergonomics is critical. And also just information to employees on get up and stretch and move. And there's some great tools out there if you go to your friend Google, but just ergonomic exercises, stretch break exercises, I think they're sometimes called, to encourage employees to get up once an hour, 2 minutes, stand where you're at. You can do it if you're on the phone, and stretch those arms and backs and legs and wrists if you're on the computer all day. And so those are critical, because a big part of what Derek and I are focused on is how do you keep your employees healthy, safe, productive, and keep them from being on a disability claim? And sometimes that's simply going to happen, but if these simple measures can help prevent that, that's clearly what our focus is.
Yep. And I know we're starting to run up against time here. So the last two that I'll mention are really emphasizing that virtual collaboration, which I think it goes into also, you know, making sure it's not all about work. And one of the things that we did early on is we went to video, and it was, you know, we weren't always comfortable going on camera, but we went to cameras, just as I mentioned before, so we could see each other face to face and we can maintain that connection. We're not always on camera, and we don't always require it. When we have a large team meeting, we like to be on camera so that we can see each other. Much easier to kind of read everybody and read the room when everybody's on camera as well. And then we also did some things early on. We haven't done this for a little bit, but we did some things early on as well, where we did some connections during business hours, but they weren't business related. So, and sometimes they were after business hours as well, but we just kind of all got on camera. I think within the first few weeks, we created a bring your kid to work day almost, where everybody brought their kids on camera for 30 minutes. I think we took a lunch period and we brought all of the kids on camera just so we could all see each other, just on our team, just to have a little bit of fun and keep it light and make those personal connections. And I know in the early days when we were still trying to figure things out, that was kind of a nice little bit of a break for all of us, just to have our kids on there with us, show them the people that we work with, something that we may not otherwise have been able to do, right? I work in Michigan, Marcy's in Tennessee, the rest of our team's in Portland, Maine. So my kids probably would never have the opportunity to meet the people that I work with were it not for these videos. So that was a great way to just kind of keep those personal connections. And now I know Marcy's son and Marcy knows my three kids. And so just a great opportunity for us to kind of keep it personal and keep it light in light of the situation and kind of going back to some of those stressors that we talked about before.
That's a great idea. And I've even seen employers who do that with pets too.
Yep.
You know, so it's a great way to connect. And I was going to give you both just a 15-second break and remind our employers who have employees in Kentucky that Retain can support them in the best practices that you've outlined as a partner in their stay at work and return to work program. And just as you all said, you know, have that presence and show them what those are as a benefit for their employees through Retain and have that physical presence of boots on the ground. And we also provide additional training opportunities as well for employers to help them implement those best practices. I think I'll apologize in advance because I think our slides got turned around here a little bit. Oops. Back up. Marcy and Derek, was there anything that you wanted to add as far as any additional information?
No, I don't think so. I think if anybody has questions that they'd like to ask now or you think of afterwards, I think I can speak for Marcy that we're both happy to help out and answer any questions that you may have.
And I know Your Unum website has great content and information as well. A lot of the things that you mentioned, I know I've seen that provides information as well. So I would just mention that and let everybody know that someone did have a question about the slides and we can make those available and send those out to the participants on the call today. If you have questions of us at Retain, you can contact us at kyretain@uky.edu. And just a reminder that this video today, as well as all of our employment seminar series are available at Retain Kentucky Media, and you could subscribe to our YouTube channel. So thank you, Marcy and Derek, for this great information. I love the content as well as the examples that you provided and all the support that you've been able to give to employers over the last 18 plus months. So thank you so much for that and the takeaways and I don't see any other questions, so I hope you all and everyone on the call has a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.